In 2017, I was lucky enough to live very close to the path of totality of the great 2017 solar eclipse. I was able to view it in a secluded rural location far away from the parking lots full of crowds that had come in from all parts of the country and indeed the world to see it. In my setting of a secluded backyard set amidst a forest, I was privy to see how nature itself reacted to the change in lighting. It was not what I had expected, even after years of having seen partial eclipses and photographs of totality. Instead, Earth became something else for a short time, and I felt that it was something like what standing on an alien world would be like. The black light-like conditions of a partially blocked sun, and the very strange calm that came with totality, left the planet I have spent every moment of my life living on feeling like it was not itself. The birds went quiet. In fact, everything went quiet, and not even the evening insects were tricked into thinking that this situation was normal, all unfolding under an eclipsed sun, with the sun's corona stretching out that no photograph can do justice to. That experience got me thinking and trying to imagine earlier periods in Earth's history where it was not the planet it is today, but rather very much like what you might expect other worlds in the universe to be like. At times in the history of this planet, it has undergone profound changes to the point that it's hard to imagine how different it once was. One of these periods of a very alien Earth compared to today was the Hadean Eon. The Hadean Eon is the first period in which Earth went through just after its accretion from the Sun's protoplanetary disk. This area is so named because the planet was a hellscape during this period, where Earth's surface was very hot and, to varying degrees, molten. The naming of this period is informal, mainly because very little geologic evidence of this period has survived, mainly some zircon crystals embedded in newer rock. But where more material from this time does exist is on the moon, and what happened on the moon during this period was probably very similar to what was happening down here on Earth. For the moon's geology, it can be divided into several periods. The first is the pre-Nectarian, stretching from 4.5 to 3.9 billion years ago, and marked by a period of volcanism and constant impacts. This then led to the Nectarian period, ranging from 3.9 billion years to 3.8, where the late heavy bombardment was in decline. Earth's atmosphere at the time would have been made up largely of hydrogen and helium, which would have been in a constant state of escape. Large areas of Earth would have been completely molten after the impact with Theia that formed the moon, when Earth was probably less than 100 million years old, during early stages of the Hadean. Imagine the aftermath of that. Not merely an asteroid impact, like that which killed the dinosaurs, but a much greater cataclysm of an entire minor planet smacking into an ever-growing major terrestrial world, leaving behind two completely molten spots on the surface stretching thousands of kilometers, in addition to rampant and widespread volcanism of a scale not seen on this Earth today. And this horrific scenario would have created something very alien to our modern senses. When you have such an enormous impact, a lot of rock gets vaporized. This would have led to a period where Earth would have briefly had a rock vapor-rich atmosphere, and while transient, it would have had this bizarre altered atmosphere for several thousand years, ultimately yielding to a hydrogen and water vapor atmosphere with a lot of carbon dioxide. This is thought to have led to a very strange situation on Earth. Earth would have accumulated a lot of water in its formation, so there would have been plenty of water present, but not in the way we see it today. Water in the atmosphere during this period would have been being lost, like the hydrogen and the helium, with an average surface temperature of 230 degrees Celsius, or 446 degrees Fahrenheit. Even though you'd think this very hot world would have vaporized all the water, it actually might not have, and there may have been oceans already present due to the very high atmospheric pressure, thought to be above 27 atmospheres. In fact, it's thought that Earth in this period may have been a complete water world before the continents rose up. But also going on was that this high carbon dioxide atmosphere was dissolving into the oceans, which can act as a carbon sink. But Earth had not yet settled into its carbon cycle, and changes in the newly formed surface would not have been stable. Instead, the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere would have varied wildly at different times. This early period of an ocean Earth, under very different conditions than what we have now, actually has some physical evidence in the form of zircon crystals from about 4.4 billion years ago that show clear evidence of two things. The first is the presence of an atmosphere and liquid water due to their geology, but it's been pointed out that Earth must have cooled down for these crystals to have formed, as their geology requires lower temperatures. Known as the Cool Early Earth Hypothesis, it posits that while 4.6 to 4.4 billion years ago, things were very hot on Earth, it may have cooled down for a time before the late heavy bombardment. This scenario may solve a mystery regarding the origins of life on Earth. During this cool period, the impact events that were going on may or may not have been as frequent or heavy as has been assumed, but rather there may have been some kind of pause before the late heavy bombardment. This would have allowed for the cool period and calm enough conditions for abiogenesis to occur, which we find evidence of it having happened very early, and the emerging evidence keeps pushing the date back further and further. In fact, there may well have been several long periods in Earth's history where life became possible, maintained it for millions of years, and then lost it again during a period of bombardment. This opens up the way for a scenario where life might have arisen on early Earth, but wasn't able to get far enough to get a foothold and was snuffed out by impacts, only for another calm period to come along and abiogenesis occurred again. You could term this as sputtering abiogenesis, where several occurrences of life on Earth have happened, but only ours got lucky and gained a foothold, and the others simply went extinct in an impact because they hadn't spread globally. In other words, their geothermal vent or their tidal pool was hit, whereas ours got lucky and did not get hit. And once our kind of life on Earth got established, at least in its microbial form, it became almost invincible, and only the sun melting the surface of the Earth as its luminosity increases can ever kill it. This also has implications on the notion of the shadow biosphere. One version of that is that we could have an entirely separate microbial biosphere on Earth that independently arose on this world and is still here, and we simply lack the ability to detect it because our methods are geared towards our type of life. But we don't understand abiogenesis very well. So another version is where abiogenesis occurs periodically and simply gets eaten by the established microbes and can't ever get a foothold. This is something where we simply have to conclude that we don't know enough to say what was happening here 4.4 to 4.1 billion years ago in regards to life. But the other mystery is plate tectonics. Earth is unusual here, and we don't know how common plate tectonics are on terrestrial worlds. Venus and Mars don't seem to have it, and it plays a huge role in the carbon cycle, vital to life on Earth now. But it's not clear just when it started. When was the Earth's surface completely molten, and when did it cool enough and plate tectonics begin? The answer here may be in Hadean rock samples from Australia that seem to suggest plate tectonics was present about 600 million years after the formation of the Earth, or about 4 billion years ago. This would have affected the atmospheric carbon dioxide and sequestered it to the point that Earth would have become somewhat similar to how it is today very quickly in its history, potentially favoring abiogenesis and survival of our brand of life on this world. This may be the key to understanding why Earth was so hot and then suddenly became so cool, as the removal of greenhouse gases were facilitated by the advent of plate tectonics, the advancement of solid rock, and thus allowing for invincible widespread life to occur, and ultimately us. But what's really at the heart of this is, again, the zircon crystals. These crystals are almost indestructible and last in the geologic record indefinitely, and like tiny time capsules, they preserve information about the conditions in which they were subject and even reveal their age. This is typically due to uranium. As uranium decays, it turns into lead, and by measuring the uranium to lead ratios in zircon crystals, you can determine their age. But more importantly, by looking at the composition of the zircon crystals, you can even glean hints about life itself. This is due to the presence of carbon in these crystals. Within the crystals, carbon-12 and carbon-13 have been detected. Life on Earth tends to prefer carbon-12, so the ratio between carbon-12 and carbon-13 can reveal the presence of life when the crystal formed, which they tend to be layered. Altogether, this seems to suggest that life on Earth appeared literally at the very first moment it could. And while the evidence from the zircon crystals for life is still not agreed upon, contamination can happen, so you need a bigger sample than we currently have, there remains a question as to whether we're actually seeing evidence of our family of life or a completely different, extinct abiogenesis incident. Incidentally, zircons found in meteorites of Martian origin indicate two things. The first is that Mars formed surprisingly quickly in the early solar system, and also that it had water very early, just like Earth. If life arose on Earth, there is no reason it couldn't have happened on Mars as well, given that the planets were under very similar conditions. And this may have also been the case for Venus. If through future study we can determine if either of those planets also spawned microbial life in separate instances of abiogenesis, then it becomes a virtual certainty that the universe teems with at least microbial life. There would be countless billions or more living worlds in the observable universe, and we'd know that they had to be there even if we couldn't directly see them. And that gets even better if life were found in the ocean of one of the ice shell moons. This would also up the chances of a previous abiogenesis on Earth having occurred, or may have occurred multiple times during the Hadean and Eoarchean periods of Earth's history. And this also applies to Venus and Mars, which may have seen multiple abiogenesis and extinction events, or have hosted shadow biospheres of their own, or the very complicated question of panspermia, where Mars may have had an original abiogenesis that was then deposited on Earth, only for the first Martian abiogenesis to go extinct, and a completely separate one to later arise. But just how abiogenesis occurred at all remains a mystery, though there are some interesting insights that have come to light. One is that scientists think that abiogenesis wasn't any one single event, but a process of evolution coming from prebiotic organic chemistry, and then on to molecular self-replication. And then eventually things like cellular membranes emerge, and eventually the process yields something that can be deemed alive. This would have all occurred under the conditions of the Hadean Eon. Given that the conditions of Earth were so radically different then from today, can Earth, under its modern conditions, still produce abiogenesis? As strange as it may seem, possibly not. It may be that something about the conditions of the Hadean Eon allowed for the chemistry of abiogenesis, but our habitable modern world may lack that, which could be a reason why we don't see life randomly appearing all the time on Earth. One interesting related tidbit here is a mysterious ancient organism known as Luca. Luca, or the last universal common ancestor, is the latest organism that all life on Earth today descends from. Studies of the genomes of archaea and bacteria show that all life on Earth has inherited 355 genes from Luca, and studies of those genes show that Luca was likely an anaerobic microorganism that existed over 4 billion years ago. There are believed to have been earlier organisms than Luca, it's just the last common ancestor, and given that they were anaerobic, it points squarely to them living in the environment of a hydrothermal oceanic vent. In fact, fossil evidence from Quebec also supports this, not long after the formation of Earth's current oceans 4.4 billion years ago. This is of course good news for the ice shell moons, like Europa and Enceladus, because if life begins at a hydrothermal vent in an ocean environment, then they are both suspected to have such vents. If life begins at hydrothermal vents, then they are nothing close to a rare phenomenon in the universe. Microbial life in this case should be everywhere. But of course there are competing theories, such as the idea that life began in a tidal pool, in which case you need a moon for life to arise, or that life arose within clay, where certain types of chemistry related to life are known to occur. Further still is the iron-sulfur world hypothesis, where life arises on the surface of iron and sulfur-bearing minerals such as pyrite. There are many more, including my favorite, the radioactive beach hypothesis, where the high water mark of an early beach accumulates radioactive materials such as uranium, possibly forming a natural nuclear reactor and giving the energy needed for the chemistry of life to get going. This situation may have led to what's known as the RNA world, where self-replicating RNA molecules led eventually to DNA, in conjunction with the appearance of cellular walls and structures, which it is not yet clear how any of that occurred. And there is the role of viruses, which probably arose in the RNA world, but the point is, with so many proposed pathways for abiogenesis to occur, it could be that there are several viable paths for it to happen. Which again ticks a box that the universe teems with microbial life. In the end, the very mysterious Hadean Eon shows us that a very alien version of Earth spawned life, not the world we currently know. In the first life, the anaerobes can't even tolerate the oxygen that hallmarks the current atmosphere. They had to retreat to anaerobic environments to survive the onslaught of the plants, as they poisoned the atmosphere with the oxygen we currently breathe. And in a sense, we come originally from very alien conditions right here on Earth, and the palette of just what can happen with life on exoplanets may be wider than we imagine. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently plugging the excellent and interesting Eastern Border podcast, link in the description below, where I recently guested for a discussion of Cold War era Soviet and American futurism and how they differed in their viewpoints. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.